Pavel Molchanov joins us from Raymond James. Pavel, good morning.
Thanks for having me.
Good. Let's do a rewind right here now, folks. Francisco Blanch of Bank of America Merrill Lynch. I talked to him this morning and we discussed how the crisis in Libya is factoring into global supplies.
Looks quite unlikely that Libya is going to be producing much oil over the next 6 months. It does seem as if the conflict is continuing to escalate. You know, we are pretty concerned that it just might take several months for Libya to start bringing oil back into the global markets.
What a mess in Libya. Pavel, you hear Francisco there talking it up. Your take on the weekend in Libya, does it mean that Brent and NYMEX move higher?
Well, I tend to agree with Francisco on this point. I think the Libyan crisis presents the most serious geopolitical risk to global oil supply since at least the Iraq War of 2003, possibly since the Gulf War all the way back in 91. As your correspondent mentioned earlier, we lost 1 million barrels a day. That's more than 1% of global supply. Now, the Saudis have brought more barrels online to compensate for that. The problem is this: if any other dominoes, so to speak, fall
right
in the Middle East, perhaps Algeria, Yemen, etc., then the reality is Saudi's ability to compensate is going to be progressively reduced and eventually reach zero. And you know, in that case, things get tough.
Let's talk about Brent versus NYMEX here. Let's bring up this chart, folks. This is that spread we've been introducing you to, and you can see it's an elegant chart. NYMEX begins to catch up to Brent, and you can see how tight they were, and then they split apart due to dynamics in America. And just in the last couple days, Pavel, we've seen NYMEX begin to catch up with Brent. A lot of people predicting we should focus on 115 rather than on 105. Do you agree with that?
I completely agree. Brent is really going to be the main benchmark for global crude oil prices, I would say at least until 2013. And the reality is that at the Cushing Hub in Oklahoma, where WTI is measured, we will have this continued physical glut for the next 2 years until the infrastructure bottlenecks get resolved. Until then, WTI is going to be almost meaningless for any company outside the United States, and in fact, even many companies within the U.S.
Which do you like better, upstream or downstream right now? With your research notes, I was fascinated with, like, and we'll do this in the next block, the idea of Exxon versus Frontier. I mean, do you want to go with the big producers out there searching for oil, whether it's Anadarko or Exxon, or do you want to go downstream more towards the refiners and the distributors of the product?
In general, I would stick with the upstream, and here is why. Both companies are really cashing in these days. Refiners, because of this WTI Brent disconnect that you mentioned. Producers, obviously, because oil is in the triple digits. But when we look at valuations, the integrateds like Exxon, BP, et cetera, are trading close to historical lows in terms of their
right
multiples. Refiners are trading well above the high end of their historical range. Now, you know, there's certainly room for upward earnings revisions for both groups, but I think from a risk-reward perspective,
okay,
the integrateds look better at this point.
Pavel Molchanov with us from Raymond James. Bring up this chart right away here. Let's bring up elegant chart four, if you would. This is Exxon and the NYMEX. Pavel, I don't get this. The NYMEX goes up, folks. That's the white line normalized back from 2009, and Exxon sounds sort of there. Why don't the oil companies more track the price of the underlying commodity?
It's a good question. I think one of the dynamics is that the multiple on many of these stocks has been compressing. So earnings have certainly been surprising on the upside. If we look at where consensus is on oil for 2011, it's about $90. Not far from where Raymond James is. And of course, we're well into the triple digits, particularly if we look at Brent. And the multiple on these stocks has been coming down. So you've had two dynamics working opposite each other. Earnings trending above expectations, multiple compressing.
Right.
Stocks have done well. They've outperformed last year. They're outperforming this year. Precisely because the multiple is so low, I think the entry point, you know, still looks quite good despite the gains.
Are they not doing as well as the underlying because they're not returning cash to shareholders? Is it because they've made dumb exploration decisions? There's got to be a why here, right?
Well, they are returning cash to shareholders. Certainly, the super majors are doing it very aggressively. Exxon's doing $5 billion a quarter in buyback alone. I think the concern of the market is that the reason we've seen the spike in crude is because of geopolitical dynamics. There are certainly scenarios where oil prices would come down, perhaps not immediately, but eventually, presumably, North Africa will calm down. And then I think the more important concern is that this will undoubtedly have an effect on economic recovery and ultimately on oil demand, because going from $80 just a few months ago to $110 is not going to be without an effect when it comes to underlying demand.
Pablo, here's a chart you know well. It's inflation-adjusted oil. Saudi Arabia light, Arab light, inflation-adjusted. We're well above where we were with Persian Gulf 1. Folks, that's that spike there just before 1992. That's Persian Gulf 1. And you can see going back to 80 how we came down, the collapse of OPEC right there at 1986. Pavel, what do you need to see for sustained? Is it like three more months of these prices, or for Exxon or Chevron, is it like a year of these prices?
Well, I think because the stocks have underperformed the commodity itself, if we see a pullback in the commodity, the pullback in the stocks is probably going to be less pronounced. So in that sense, as I said, the risk-reward trade-off looks pretty good right now.
Right.
Certainly, if oil stays in the triple digits, you know, for an entire year, then I would expect to see these stocks meaningfully higher than where they are today.
Pavel, let's look at this chart off your research notes. Chevron versus Frontier Oil. First of all, who is Frontier Oil? I assume that's a name not a lot of our viewers know. What does Frontier Oil do?
Sure. Frontier Oil is an independent refiner that is focused on the Mid-Continent region, sort of the Texas Panhandle, Oklahoma, Kansas. It's actually merging, in the process of merging, with another independent refiner called Holly. And these two companies are very nicely leveraged to the WTI Brent disconnect. In other words, they're able to source cheaper crudes. So paying $105 instead of $150
cool.
a barrel,
yeah.
Capturing those economics.
Well, with the capture them, does that mean you prefer that over Chevron? Bring up that elegant chart again, if you would. You see Chevron and Frontier normalized back to 2007. And Pavel, I'm sorry. I mean, Frontier's way behind, and you're suggesting they will catch up versus a big one like Chevron, a super major like Chevron.
Well, you know, again, I think there's room for both in a portfolio. Frontier is, of course, much smaller company, a few billion market cap. Chevron's $150 billion. Chevron is more of a yield and share buyback story. Frontier is more what I would call earnings momentum. So I think, you know, for the smaller cap folks, a little more aggressive,
right.
Frontier looks quite interesting. Chevron is really a more defensive, more conservative play.
What's your single best buy now? Raymond James has such a reputation of finding these wonderful smaller stocks that the people up in New York don't follow. What's your single best buy right now?
Here's an idea for you. This one is leveraged to the oil market, but it's not actually an oil company. It's a biofuel company. It's called Gevo. G-E-V-O.
I just feel like Pim Fox right now. This is just like, it's like taking stock. I had a Pim Fox moment there. Continue, Pavel. Gevo?
There you go. Gevo, G-E-V-O, about $600 million market cap. This is a biofuel company. They're making a very interesting biofuel called isobutanol. Early stage company. The stock is close to $20 right now. I think the room for market adoption is very sizable. It's just getting up its scale-up curve or coming down the cost curve, if you'd like. And
is isobutanol,
the commercialization here looks very solid.
For those of you with gray hair, I'm having a Morrison and Boyd moment. That's a textbook on organic chemistry in school. Pavel, you're too young to remember Morrison and Boyd. It's like methyl ethyl ketone. Isobutanol, is that like an ethanol substitute?
It is. So unlike ethanol, isobutanol has a lot of different uses, and it's not subject to the same kind of pipeline and refining bottlenecks. And it can be used not just in the fuel market, but also in specialty chemicals. So instead of selling product at $2.20 a gallon, which is where ethanol is these days, they're selling product more like $4 a gallon, capturing much better margins. And I think it's a far, far more sustainable business than your typical kind of old school ethanol business.
Pavel, absolutely fantastic.